previously on The Science Of.
There are plenty of scientific conversations going on in the country. These conversations are good and need to be had.
There is a disturbing trend in America today.
I think he was speaking colloquially.
This is not a detective grilling a suspect. This is not a cook grilling a steak. I say the word there, or the word to, or the word your. Context is important here. You cannot simply switch up the spellings of these words arbitrarily. The same thing applies to scientific versus colloquial definitions. It's all about context. Science has its own scientific definitions of words. So with that in mind, the next few videos will be explaining the scientific meanings of words which are too often used colloquially.
And now, the continuation.
Hello, Internet, and welcome to The Science Of, using sci-fi and the news to educate people on how science actually works here in the real world. Today's topic is a word which many people use incorrectly, regardless of whether or not they are defenders of science. Granted, the general understanding the defenders of science have for the word is still better than most who don't fall under that category. The general understanding still could be improved upon. The word of the day is theory, and it's been used colloquially in science conversations for too long. Since scientists are obsessed with everyone getting it right, I will define and demonstrate the scientific nature of the word. All of the definitions I have used I am getting from these science textbooks for the first science course for science majors in each major discipline. Details in the description. I would really appreciate it if you actually double-check these definitions before commenting, because that's the best way to either call me out on steering you awry or to verify that I am speaking truth to you. There are 5 popular textbook definitions for the word which are common among the main branches of science. Each of these definitions vary from one another, but they all hit the same 2 points. 1. They explain, describe, and make predictions about reality. And 2, they are supported by a vast amount of observational and experimental evidence, to the point where they have passed a multitude of thorough checks on its validity while failing none of them. Another point which the definition from the Environment book brings up is the fact that each experiment or set of observations done on the theory has to go through a peer review process. While this is true, it is more of a necessary follow-up to a theory rather than part of the definition of one. The peer review process and the development of theory are both separate but vital steps in the scientific process. Now, there are a couple very well-known examples of theories which fit the bill here. The theory of gravity and the theory of general relativity. Both of these theories fit every aspect of the definitions of theory. Both of these theories explain, describe, and make predictions about reality. They both have been through the scientific process in full, and they are very well substantiated. This brings me to one major misconception about theories. While yes, we as scientists can be extremely certain that a scientific theory is true, we realize that we cannot be absolutely certain that a theory holds. Now, some of you may have just asked, what the hell is he talking about? Or maybe you're asking, if that's the case, then why the hell should I trust these fanciful science types if they're never 100% certain? I'm going to let you in on a little secret. The reason we cannot be 100% certain is because we know, better than most, that theory confirmation is restricted by technological limitations. The resolutions of the devices we use in science have certain downfalls which limit their accuracy. For example, Isaac Newton's theory of gravity would have been a wee bit more advanced if he had a vacuum chamber and a high-speed camera. Also, there is always the possibility of certain pieces of the puzzle of a particular theory being missing. For example, Newton's theory of gravity was incomplete for traveling at speeds near the speed of light, which is why photons and other near-speed-of-light objects were so hard to theorize about. It wasn't until Albert Einstein developed his theory of general relativity that those near-light speed corrections to the theory of gravity could be made. Presently, the seemingly final missing piece in the theory of gravity is tying it with the quantum mechanical model, which deserves an entire series on this channel. I have left out the well-known and seemingly political theory of evolution. Up until this point, it was intentional in order to get the foundation of the scientific use of the word theory into your minds before getting into the controversial topic of evolution. I will get to that theory in another video because it does require its own time. Now, I have brought up concepts which require their own videos, so make sure you subscribe to my channel to see more. Don't forget to like, favorite, and share this video, and as always, until next time, keep learning, keep growing, and keep improving the world around you.